Welcome to the motherfucking relay. We're covering today's top boxing news.
Gervonta Davis versus Hugo Ruiz. Let's talk about the fight. Well, this went pretty much as expected. You know, I didn't have any illusions about this fight, any illusions about what I was going to see. I don't know if you guys did, but Hugo Ruiz was standing in for Abner Mares.
We know.
And on that kind of notice, with this kind of an opponent, you don't need to be Nostradamus to know what's going to happen.
Of course not. It's a showcase fight.
Hugo Ruiz ended up absorbing a blistering right hook, and that right hook was enough for him to take a knee and make the decision that, you know, he doesn't really want to go on. And that just highlights how ill-equipped
Hugo was,
how unprepared Hugo Ruiz was for this fight. It's for this reason that I warned ahead of time that, you know, even if Gervonta Davis goes in there and blows this guy out of the water, you really can't read too much into it because Hugo Ruiz has done absolutely nothing at 130 pounds. He doesn't in any way, shape, or form represent the best and brightest of that weight class, and this is little more than a showcase fight intended to decorate Gervonta Davis's highlight reel, and that's what they did.
Pretty much.
You can't really even make a proper assessment of how good or how good Gervonta Davis isn't because it's a showcase fight, you understand.
To make him look good.
It's a fight that is designed to make him look good. So if he ends up going out there and he ends up looking good, well, that's what was supposed to happen. Thus, it's not an accurate barometer for what Gervonta Davis is made of, where his skill set is, how much has he grown as a fighter. You know, it's a wonder he even still has that WBA title. Alberto Machado never actually got a real explanation from the WBA as to how is it that Gervonta Davis ends up being the super champion, even though Alberto was in contention for that title before that.
Did y'all forget?
We all know the story. Alberto Machado fought Jezreel Corrales. Jezreel lost the title on the scales, thereby making the title only available for Alberto to win it. But Alberto won the fight, so in theory, he should have won the title in that moment. But that's not what happened. You fast forward, somehow the WBA in all their wisdom decided
to give it to Gervonta.
Make Davis versus Cuellar for that same title, the title that should have went to Alberto. I reiterate, Alberto never really got an explanation for that. But we know how these sanctioning bodies work, and we know who they're looking out for themselves.
Pretty much.
If you give Alberto a lesser version of the title, and then you award the major version of the title to Gervonta, well, that's two times the sanctioning fees. Keeping these baby belts, these trinkets, you know, because these aren't full versions of titles. That's what Alberto ended up with, a baby belt. But by keeping those baby belts, along with a major belt, in circulation, it allows them to collect more sanctioning fees from different fighters. So we can see what the rhyme and the reason was there. That, coupled with some opportunism from Gervonta's handlers, it opens a door for him to be called the world champion, even though for all intents and purposes, he shouldn't be. But he is.
We know.
If you've been paying attention to how Gervonta Davis's career is being handled and how he's being guided as a fighter, it seems like they're less concerned with making him a better fighter and more concerned with making him a moneymaker through creative matchmaking. Smoke, mirrors, the whole ball. I mean, even now, there are reports circulating that Mayweather plans to match Gervonta Davis against Tenshin Nusukawa. You might remember that name because that's the small Asian kid that Mayweather knocked out
in that exhibition
not too long ago in an exhibition match.
Slash circus.
So once again, you can see the rhyme and the reason that goes on.
And why.
And what the intentions of Gervonta Davis's handlers are. They're not actually concerned with making him a better fighter, allowing him to develop fully, fight by fight, so much as they want to turn him into a moneymaker. A moneymaker that may not even have money-making skills. Because, I mean, really, how much could Gervonta Davis's skills have developed in 2018 when he only fought once? And how much skill do you think it took to take out Hugo Ruiz, a guy who's not even in his weight class? These kinds of lighter touches, there's a time and a place, you know, everybody's got them, more or less. There's a time and a place for them. But when you're constantly putting your fighter in these kinds of situations, the question then becomes, is this conducive towards the growth of the fighter? Is he actually getting better by constantly being put in opportunistic situations derived from creative matchmaking? And you'll find that the answer might be no. I mean, how much better do you have to be? Or how much better can you get when you don't have to be? At least not for the guys they're putting in there with Gervonta Davis. So in regards to reacting to Gervonta Davis versus Hugo Ruiz post-fight, well, it's hard to react to it because it was barely a fight. And I figured that Hugo Ruiz could barely put up a fight. This was a guy ill-prepared for this kind of a matchup. So my reaction is basically that was everything I expected it to be. Hugo was as unprepared as I expected him to be. And the intention was to decorate Gervonta Davis's highlight reel. That's what I thought they were trying to do. That's what they did. And here we are. That's my reaction. It's self-explanatory. Just another case of causality. No surprises. Now, as far as what's next for Gervonta Davis, Mayweather disclosed to the public that he intends to match Gervonta Davis against Tenshin Nasukawa sometime in April. He'd fight Tenshin in an exhibition on Rizin in April and then have a real sanctioned boxing match in May. Now, this further illustrates how, you know, his handlers seem less concerned with his development and more concerned with just making him a media darling, but it's having the opposite effect because...
What's the point?
What exactly is the point of matching him against Tenshin Nasukawa? We already know boxing's not that guy's strong suit, in which case, what would be the point and the purpose in matching Gervonta Davis against Tenshin Nasukawa other than to...
Scam people?
Bilk a couple of idiots into attending that fight. Now, one guy who's offering himself up as Gervonta Davis's next opponent is Javier Fortuna, who had a successful night of his own against Sharif Bogaer. And Javier won a unanimous decision on all three judges' scorecards. It was scored a unanimous decision. And you know, Javier's a guy that's been around the block. Javier's a guy that's a good litmus test for a young up-and-coming fighter because Javier is going to give you something. He's actually going to give you something to have to work around.
He's there to fight.
And rather than matching Gervonta Davis against guys from 126 or kickboxers who dabble in boxing, Javier Fortuna would make more sense. More sense
than they would
in the realm of allowing Gervonta Davis to develop and hone his skills against a seasoned veteran. Now, for this potential fight to take place, you know, Javier Fortuna hasn't competed below 135 pounds in about 2 years. The last time that Javier Fortuna fought at the 130-pound limit was 2016 against Jason Sosa. Javier lost that fight. So if what Javier wants is a Gervonta Davis fight, it's conceivable that he might have to make that weight, or they could meet at some kind of a catch weight.
A few pounds over.
Just above 130. Thing is, you know, if they have that kind of a situation, I'm not quite sure it would even be a title fight. Because that's a 130-pound title Gervonta Davis is holding, not 131, not 132. It's a 130-pound title. Thus, if he were to meet Javier Fortuna at some kind of catchweight just above 130, it's conceivable that it wouldn't be for a world title. Making it even more redundant that Gervonta Davis, since becoming the WBA's 130-pound champion, hasn't fought any 130-pound fighters. And it seems to be a weight that even he is struggling to make. You know, Gervonta Davis is kind of caught between a rock and a hard place. On one hand, you seem to have spent quite a bit of time on the couch in 2018.
Mm-hmm.
Very recently, you had to step on the scales more than once to try to make the weight, and you're not actually fighting fighters at your weight.
Not even.
You're fighting guys from 126. It's an odd situation because Gervonta Davis, for what it's worth, he is a talented fighter. The potential is there, but I'm of the opinion that the mismanagement of his career is why a lot of people give him so many criticisms, why he gets so much negative press, that this is a kid that could be doing more because he's got the tools.
He's got talent.
But, you know, the job they're doing with him, I, you know, what are you going to say? So to surmise my thoughts on Gervonta Davis's performance last night and his recent endeavors, at least the ones they've got lined up for him. You know, the writing's been on the wall about this kid for some time. Some people just don't want to read it.
And that's okay.
But those guys that don't want to read the writing on the wall, they only make up a small portion of the boxing community. Thus, everyone else that's out there and is watching this, how his career is being handled, they can read between the lines. They can see that his handlers are less concerned with making him a good, well-rounded, and developed fighter, and they're more concerned with just making him a commercial success by any means necessary, no matter how creative they have to get with the opponents. Because so far, they've matched you against 226-pound fighters, and now they want to match you against the same kickboxer
Tension.
That Mayweather just beat up. You can see what the rhyme and the reason for all of this shit is. They just want to make Gervonta popular. But he's getting popular for all the wrong reasons. So in the pursuit of fame, what they're ending up with as a result is infamy. It seems almost like they want to make him as polarized and as hated by some as Mayweather was. This may be their means and method to replicate the Mayweather formula by making Gervonta Davis a polarized fighter. But I'll say that it's a bit soon in that kid's career for that kind of a strategy because he's still got more growing to do as a fighter. And what they're trying to do is grow his profile instead of growing his skill set. And without further attention to detail in regards to his skill set, in regards to what he can actually do in the ring against elite-level opponents that, well, honestly, hadn't faced in a long time. Without that attention to detail, it's very hard to imagine that people are going to start liking Gervonta Davis or that he's suddenly going to become what they're trying to make him out to be. You know, people can see through the smoke and through the mirrors, and it's for that reason that, you know, my take, they're not really doing him any favors. They're doing him a great disservice by handling his career in this fashion, and those are my thoughts. Moving on. You know, we saw how the WBA got very creative with Gervonta Davis becoming their super champion at 130 pounds, and it appears that that same creativity is being applied elsewhere. You see, it was very recently reported that the WBA's committee decided that Canelo Alvarez should be champion not just at middleweight, but at super middleweight as well. That's right. It appears he's going to be holding on to that WBA baby belt. Which is kind of a redundancy, because what does that mean exactly? That Canelo Alvarez is going to be campaigning at two different weights at the same time? I mean, this would effectively mean that all those propositions about David Lemieux's upcoming fight with John Ryder being for that same belt, this would effectively debunk those previous reports that stated that Lemieux was going to be fighting for that title because Canelo intended to vacate it. Well, apparently, that's not so. Now, I don't really know what use Canelo Alvarez is going to have of that WBA baby belt when his next fight is at middleweight.
Because he's just going to have it there for decoration.
One can only imagine that he'll maybe hang on to it as a marketing tool, you know, that if he wants to fight somebody at just above middleweight, they can call it a title fight, hence the baby belt. Maybe that's the rhyme and the reason. Now, we know what the WBA's rhyme and reason is also, that one way or another, that allows them to collect big sanctioning fees from Canelo Alvarez, whether he fights as a middleweight or as a super middleweight. Thus, you can see the rhyme and the reason as to why they'd want him to hang on to that belt. They want to be in the Canelo Alvarez business. This is another tactless decision from the WBA, who's got enough goofball cheeseburger belts floating around without allowing Canelo Alvarez to hold on to another. In the span of two weight classes, no less. You know, this is a part of the reason that a lot of people say that the sport is diluted. This actively dilutes the sport because you got several guys in the same weight class, and all of them are some kind of champion, and that's just with one organization. I mean, how many baby belts does the WBA keep in rotation? You know, you got regular champions and world champions and super champions and interim champions.
And it
goes on. And that's just one organization, you understand. That's just one sanctioning body. The WBC does the same fucking thing. You know, they got the WBC champion, the WBC interim champion, the WBC diamond, the WBC silver, and you're thinking to yourself the whole time, okay, who's the actual champion here? Who is the guy to beat? Now, hardcores like me and you, we can distinguish which is which. Which belts can be unified with those of a rival organization. Hardcores can do that, but casuals can't. And because they can't, it kind of takes away from the prestige of being a champion when you've got two, three, four guys with that same designation running around in the same weight class. This is a part of the reason that, you know, in some circles, there is a wish, I should say, for one organization to rule them all, one commission, one board, one entity that decides what goes on in the sport, because the division of the sport itself creates a lot of issues. The division that we see in the sanctioning bodies, the division that we see in promotional outfits that form relationships with certain networks.
Creates problems.
That division takes away from what the sport could be and the prestige itself of just, you know, world champions. That being a world champion shouldn't be a designation that a guy gets just because he can drum up a few fans, but that's the case, and that's likely the reason that the WBA is allowing Canelo Alvarez to hold on to that baby belt, even though his next fight is at middleweight. The only real saving grace in all of this is that belt that they're allowing Canelo Alvarez to hold, that's not the full version of the world title itself. That's not the full version. Calum Smith's got the full version. And in that way, unification fights are still possible. Mandatories should, in theory, still get their title shot. So it's not holding up the ranks as much as if it were a full version of a title that Canelo Alvarez was holding. But nevertheless, it's still shameless, it's still tactless, and it's more of the same from the alphabets. And finally, I saw this and found it quite interesting. Joseph Parker basically went on to say that between Anthony Joshua and Dillian White, he feels that Dillian White is the heavier puncher. And his reason for this is because, you know, in the Dillian White fight, he actually got knocked down. And he said that there were several shots that landed on him that really stunned him. Now, if you compare both of those fights, you compare both of them, how Anthony Joshua looked in his fight with Parker and how White looked in his fight with Parker, those guys go about things in a very different way. And what do they say? Styles make fights. So, where you got Anthony Joshua using his jab to keep you off and being very cautious, using his boxing, as opposed to Dillian White's approach, throwing caution to the wind to get mid-range to inside so he can land bombs, it's a very different situation.
Between the two guys.
Because at its base, if you asked me, I'd say that Anthony Joshua is still the heavier-handed puncher. He just goes about landing those punches in a very different way than Dillian does. Now, with respect to Joseph Parker's insights, because at the end of the day, he's been inside of the ring with both. So, with respect to his insights, I could see how he would come to a conclusion like that. You know, one of these guys knocked you down, and one of these guys didn't. But the reason one of these guys knocked you down, it's not because he's a heavier puncher than the other guy. It's because of how he goes about landing those punches. I mean, if we're really going to discuss this thing, then we have to look at the characteristics of both fights and what was different about them. How is it that Joseph Parker would come to a conclusion like that?
One of them put him down.
And the best way to characterize it is, well, one fight was more of a chess match, and one wasn't. One guy is more of a chess player, and one guy's more of a come-forward brawler. Now, in a Joseph Parker versus Anthony Joshua fight, a good portion of it, Joseph Parker was trying to fight the fight from the outside. Thus, from that range, maybe you're not as likely to feel his power shots there. Because you're not being aggressive, because you're laying off, because you're circling away. It's a different kind of fight. Whereas with Dillian White, whether you're laying off or you're laying it on, he's going to come forward and you're more likely to feel his power shots because he's compromising defense for offense to land those shots. It's a different kind of fight. And that's a big part of the reason I think that Joseph Parker came to this conclusion. Now, this is all with respect to his insights, because I reiterate, he's been in the ring with both guys. So he's got insights that me and you aren't going to have. But I'm of the opinion that Joshua is the more concussive puncher. He just goes about landing those punches in a different way. Because lest we forget, Dillian White was subject to Anthony Joshua's power. And Dillian White got put on his ass. So, you know, those are just my thoughts. Feel free to disagree.